Welcome. I'm Catherine Hadro, and this is EWTN Pro-Life Weekly.
I have made no commitment to anyone, not in this Senate, not over at the White House, about how I would decide any case.
Under scrutiny, Judge Amy Coney Barrett faces the cameras, the questions, and the Senate Judiciary Committee as her Supreme Court nomination moves closer to a vote. A rare breed, what it's like to be a pro-life Democrat during a Trump presidency. As he prepares to leave Congress, Representative Dan Lipinski shares what he thinks is the most urgent issue facing the pro-life movement. And did black employees face discrimination at Planned Parenthood? We have the results of an internal audit. Judge Amy Coney Barrett sat for hours of grueling questioning this week before the Senate Judiciary Committee. Topics ranged from her judicial stance on the Affordable Care Act to voting rights to the peaceful transfer of power. But as expected, much of the focus was on pro-life issues and Barrett's stance on Roe v. Wade. The chairman of the committee underscored the significance of Barrett's nomination.
This is history being made, folks. This is the first time in American history that we've nominated a woman who's unashamedly pro-life and embraces her faith without apology, and she's going to the court. Seat at the table is waiting on you, and it will be a great signal to all young women who want to, who share your view of the world, that there's a seat at the table for them.
Barrett faced more pointed questions from Democrats. Several of them asked about her pro-life stances as a private citizen and law professor, including letters she had signed over the years at church and at the University of Notre Dame supporting the Catholic Church's teaching on life. Those senators wanted to know if her personal views as a private citizen would affect her application of the law as a justice on the Supreme Court.
What does it mean for, quote, the unborn to be protected in law? Does that statement mean there is no valid constitutional protection for an abortion and therefore Roe v. Wade should be overturned?
I think that statement is an affirmation of life. You know, it points out that we express our love and support for the mothers who bear them. Again, it was a statement validating the position of the Catholic University at which I worked in support for life and to, you know, support women in crisis pregnancies, to support babies. So it's really no more than the expression of a pro-life view.
To discuss this week's confirmation hearing, joining us now via Skype is Nicole Garnett, a professor at the University of Notre Dame School of Law, a former colleague of Judge Amy Coney Barrett. She's also a longtime friend and neighbor. Also joining us via Skype is Marjorie Dannenfelser, president of the Susan B. Anthony List and co-chair of Pro-Life Voices for Trump. Thank you both for being here. Nicole, first, we've all been watching and listening to Judge Amy Coney Barrett this week. Before we dive into the hearing, can you tell us about the Amy Coney Barrett that you know? I understand she is the godmother of one of your daughters.
She is. She's our daughter, Libby, Elizabeth Ann. Our daughter Libby's godmother. Amy and Jesse are the godparents to our daughter. So I have known Amy Barrett for 22 years. We clerked together on the Supreme Court, and then we have been on the faculty at Notre Dame together for 17 years. She's my neighbor and one of my closest friends. If you want to know what kind of person she is, you might just ask, well, why? Who do you want to be the godmother to your children? Amy and Jesse are incredible people, people of principle, people of faith, the kind of people that you really want, that your children will look up to as role models. And in my own personal life as a mom of four, the kind of people that, you know, I turn to, Amy in particular, for mom advice at those times when sometimes parenting can be challenging, particularly when you're balancing a career. So she is exactly what you see if you've been watching the hearings, a woman of great inner strength and poise and grace with a great mind who can hold her own against anyone.
Marjorie, what has stood out to you from the Senate confirmation hearings this week?
What has stood out to me is the incredible discipline on the part of the Democrats to be very focused on the election to make a legislative and policy pronouncements all day long, every day, trying to nail her down on what policy ends that she might want to achieve. Of course, every single step of the way, she's jumping back, pushing back, saying the role, what a role of a judge is, what a role of a legislator is, and how those are so important to keep separate. The other thing that is remarkable is what you heard and saw in that clip of Senator Graham communicating beautifully and strongly the pro-life moment that this is for women in this country, for women who are not, who may respect Ruth Bader Ginsburg and the other women on the court, but are not like them, have a different worldview. This is a time, a moment where there's a seat at the table, and what a woman to establish that seat. Amy Coney Barrett is just been beautiful to watch.
Nicole, I want to take a listen to something Judge Barrett said in an exchange with Senator Dianne Feinstein. Let's take a listen.
Do you agree with Justice Scalia's view that Roe was wrongly decided?
Senator, I completely understand why you are asking the question, but again, I can't pre-commit or say, yes, I'm going in with some agenda, because I'm not. I don't have any agenda. I have no agenda to try to overrule Casey. I have an agenda to stick to the rule of law and decide cases as they come.
Nicole, not only are you a close friend of Judge Barrett, you're a law professor yourself, and you clerked on the Supreme Court for Justice Clarence Thomas. Can you expand on what Judge Barrett meant by that comment?
Of course. So there is there's both sort of an ethical obligation on the part of a sitting judge to never pre-commit herself to any decision that might, in a case that might come before her. That's actually a legal rule that she's bound by as a sitting judge on the United States Court of Appeals. But I also think she expressed it really well today. She has also a moral obligation and a professional obligation to future litigants to make clear to every party that comes before her that she has not prejudged any case, that she will take every case as it comes, read the briefs, understand the precedent, and try to understand the Constitution or the statute and apply the law to the case before her. So she really can't, no matter how many times they ask her, say what she thinks, generally speaking, about a legal issue that may come before her on the Seventh Circuit or on the Supreme Court, because we don't allow in our constitutional system judges to decide cases in the abstract. We only allow in our constitutional system judges to decide real cases with real parties, with real laws, with real facts. So she is just reiterating what is her ethical and professional obligation as a judge to not pre-commit herself to any position in any on any issue that might come before the court.
Marjorie, how do you interpret that exchange and the questions facing Amy Coney Barrett over Roe v. Wade?
Well, I think it has everything, again, to do with the election. I think they know that we have the votes to win this. Nothing is certain, but I think they think that we're probably going to win this confirmation. But where they can score points is in the minds of the voter. And if they do score those points and we lose the presidency and we lose the Senate, then the practice of court packing, which is a very real threat, which turns the Supreme Court into a super legislature. Each time we don't like what the Supreme Court says, we just add more justices in order to get a result that we do like, that is a very real threat. And so I interpret those exchanges as multi-leveled. Civics lesson, trying to pin her down and prejudice her, but also ultimately to sway voters in the election.
Democratic senators were walking a tightrope to avoid another "the dogma lives loudly within you" moment, but they still did raise questions surrounding Judge Barrett's Catholic faith in order to raise the issue of how her faith might impact her future rulings on abortion. Let's take a listen to this.
In 2006, you signed an open letter that's published in the South Bend Tribune. You, on one side, the advertisement describes the legacy of Roe versus Wade as barbaric. On the other side, what you signed, you stated that you oppose abortion demand, defend the right to life from fertilization to natural death.
Senator, the statement that I signed, as you said, simply said, I signed it on the way out of church. It was consistent with the views of my church, and it simply said, we support the right to life from conception to natural death.
I'm not aware of any law or provision of the Constitution that says that if you are a member of the Catholic Church and adhere to the teachings of the Catholic Church, or you have religious convictions in line with those of your church teaching, that you're therefore barred from office. Are you aware of any constitutional provision to that effect?
The religious test clause would make it unconstitutional.
Nicole, this letter that Justice Barrett signed came up again and again and again in the hearings. Can you speak to whether a practicing Catholic can be a fair and impartial jurist?
Of course, that's an easy answer. Of course they can. As she's demonstrated in over 100 judicial opinions and has sat on over 600 cases since assuming her current position on the Seventh Circuit, she has taken an oath to uphold the Constitution and the law of the land. She has promised that whatever her personal views are, they will not color her role as a judge, and she has demonstrated that to be the case. And by the way, I sign that letter every year, too.
Marjorie, what's your reaction to questions involving Judge Barrett's Catholic beliefs and the pro-life letters that she's signed?
Yeah, applying the law is, of course, the answer every single time. It can be said a thousand different ways, and she has. What he's really getting at also is that he doesn't think a woman like she could possibly be who she says she is, and that she will roll history back to a place where women are discriminating. In fact, he said exactly that. He can't simply get his mind around the idea that women have decided, many women, most women, that it has not been the great liberator abortion has, not been the great liberator that it was proposed to be. Great lie is that it absolutely has not been, and that we cannot build our rights on the broken rights of other people. That is something that he can't get his mind around. And he's looking at an incredibly successful woman who is obviously not a person who has been discriminated against, perhaps, but also would never discriminate against somebody else. And look where she's been. Look where she's arrived. She's a model for all women who are coming up right now.
Nicole, there seems to be a lot of fascination with the fact that Amy Coney Barrett is a mother of seven. I have to wonder whether the late Justice Scalia got the same attention for having nine children. What do you make of the media chatter facing her family size, and what does it reveal to you about our culture today?
Well, I think our culture today, everyone that I talk to has, you know, outside of the chattering class, admires her as a mother. And as someone who's been able to integrate her faith and her family and her professional career, Amy and Jesse have always been models for us as parents and as a couple. They're models for my two daughters who are now 16 and 21, and they're models for many, many young women who really do want to ask questions about how they can better integrate professional life with family life. So seven is a lot. I only have four, and that seems like a lot of work to me. But I really think most people just think it's a beautiful thing, an admirable thing, that she's able to do all that she's able to do and do it so well while still being a loving mother to seven kids.
And Marjorie, last question. Your team, I know, has been traveling the U.S. and holding Confirm Amy rallies. What have you been hearing from the grassroots?
Well, we've been hearing at the doors just great admiration and surprise over how quickly these hearings are going and how much better it is than we were worried that it would go. Also, the concern about core PAC and the concern that this that the Vice President Biden and Harris will not lay aside that threat to the future. But it's the base is far more optimistic than it was a week ago. I think we'll see that in polling in the next couple of weeks. It's an exciting moment, and the timing could not be better.
Mm. Nicole and Marjorie, thank you both for being here.
Thanks so much for having us.
Thank you. This week, as we've been reporting, Judge Amy Coney Barrett faced Senate confirmation hearings. President Trump appointed Barrett, a Catholic mother of seven and former Notre Dame law professor, to replace the late Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg on the Supreme Court. The chairman of the Judiciary Committee, Senator Lindsey Graham, said this is a historical moment, as it's the first pro-life woman who embraces her faith to be nominated to the Supreme Court. That brings us to this week's call to action. Go to prolifeweekly.com and tell your senators to confirm Amy Coney Barrett. Having Barrett, a Catholic and constitutionalist, on the Supreme Court bench could have a major impact on the pro-life cause for decades to come. At our website, we've drafted letters that you can directly send to your senators. You can, of course, change the wording to whatever you would like. Let's encourage our senators to swiftly confirm Amy Coney Barrett to the Supreme Court. Write to your senators by going to prolifeweekly.com. Congressman Dan Lipinski says Catholics do not fit neatly into one political party. The outgoing representative told me that in part one of our interview, which you saw last week. And those views come through clearly in the second part of our sit-down discussion. The pro-life Democrat, who will be leaving Congress at the end of this term, speaks openly about his views on the death penalty, working under House Speaker Nancy Pelosi's leadership, and what it's been like to be a pro-life Democrat during a Trump administration. Here's part two of my interview with Representative Dan Lipinski. What do you see as the most pressing pro-life issue today?
Well, it's unfortunate that we have been in many ways pushed onto defense, and certainly the Hyde Amendment now is under threat, which, you know, was, I remember talking to Jim Oberstar, the late Jim Oberstar, the Democrat, who would always talk to me about how instrumental he was in the late 1970s in getting that language in there to say that no federal funding for abortion, and then no federal funding for health insurance plans that covered abortion. And that appears that, Democratic Party has made it clear they want to get rid of that now, and so that is the biggest issue.
Representative Lipinski says while the political side is an important part of advancing the pro-life cause, it's most important to change hearts and minds. That will be Lipinski's mission as he prepares to depart Capitol Hill at the end of his term in January. The 8-term Illinois representative lost his primary to an abortion lobby-backed opponent earlier this year. Lipinski tells EWTN Pro-Life Weekly he'll stay involved with the pro-life movement and plans to write and speak about being Catholic in the public square. He cites his Catholic faith in shaping his views on the life issue, including on capital punishment. Do you view the death penalty as a pro-life issue as well?
The death penalty is an issue that when I first came to Congress, that I still support the death penalty. It is something that as years have gone on that I've generally have changed my my views on. There's certainly a debate in the Catholic Church over the death penalty. Recent popes have made it clear that they believe the death penalty goes against Catholic teaching. It's not something that is really definitive with everyone when we're talking about Catholic teaching, but I think that it's something that I now do oppose the death penalty, and I have changed on that. I think it's different in some ways, but I think it's something that I certainly stand against now.
When asked if there are other pro-life Democrats in Congress, Lipinski points to Representative Colin Peterson of Minnesota, but says it's difficult to name others.
It's just very tough to win a Democratic primary now if you are pro-life, and that's the problem that we're facing.
How does being a pro-life Democrat in a Trump administration compare to being a pro-life Democrat in previous administrations? What is this political climate like?
Well, it's it's something that I have talked to friends of mine who have been supporters of President Trump, who are in the pro-life movement, and I have said to them, and I've said this over the last 4 years. I said I think it's a concern to me that Donald Trump becomes the face of the pro-life movement, and I think that's detrimental to us in the long run. Now, I applaud many things that President Trump has done when it comes to protecting life. And I don't support President Trump, but I am grateful that he has taken those positions. He has, it surprised me, honestly. I thought it would be one of the first things that he abandoned after the election, and I'm glad that he has not. But I do see a problem in that. Look, the abortion supporters, they want to make Donald Trump the face of the pro-life movement because they want to say that anyone who is pro-life is like Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of things about Donald Trump that we know are not what we want to model, what we want to live ourselves or for our children. And so I think that's a problem. I've been labeled anti-woman because I'm pro-life, and it's easier when they can point to Donald Trump and some of the things that Donald Trump has said, things that he's been accused of, and that makes it more difficult. And that's a problem. And it's been easy for my opponents to say that I'm with Donald Trump, or I support Donald Trump because I'm pro-life, he's pro-life, and therefore I must be like Donald Trump and support everything that Donald Trump supports. That has made it more difficult with Donald Trump as president.
A lot of pro-lifers are critical of House Speaker Nancy Pelosi. She is Catholic, but she does advance pro-abortion legislation. You've worked in Congress under Pelosi's leadership. What do you think our Catholic viewers should know about her?
Well, I think people know a lot already about her. I'm not close with Nancy Pelosi. I'll have to admit that. It always gets to be into a tough space when someone says that they are a Catholic, that they, you know, really are adhering to their Catholic faith. They are working to live it out, but then they take a position that is very contrary to being Catholic. Nancy Pelosi certainly has done that, but I don't ever want to try to judge anyone, judge their soul. Clearly, Nancy Pelosi is wrong when it comes to the abortion issue. Her position is counter to the Catholic Church, and that's a problem. But how she's working out her Catholic faith, which I tend to believe that she takes seriously, that is really between her and God, between her and her pastor. And so that's all I'd want to say on that.
Thank you to Representative Dan Lipinski for taking the time to speak with us. Coming up, is there anti-black bias at Planned Parenthood? The results of an internal audit. And a beacon of holiness for young people is beatified in Assisi. The mother of Carlo Acutis shares a beautiful pro-life connection as her son continues on the path towards sainthood. Welcome back to EWTN Pro-Life Weekly. I'm Catherine Hadro. An internal audit reveals dozens of black employees said they faced racism at Planned Parenthood. That is this week's Speak Out segment. BuzzFeed News reports they obtained an internal assessment which reveals black employees at Planned Parenthood's national wing feel they are held to a different standard than white employees and are often expected to work more and are given less leeway. The audit was commissioned by Planned Parenthood and presented last week, according to BuzzFeed News. It was based on interviews with 64 current and 12 former black Planned Parenthood employees in all divisions and levels of Planned Parenthood Federation of America. A contracted third-party group conducted the assessment and found the organization's black employees feel Planned Parenthood's treatment of them internally does not line up with its social justice mission. According to BuzzFeed News, black employees told AORTA, the group that conducted the assessment, they regularly experienced acts of racism and anti-blackness from their white colleagues, but found that when they reported problems to human resources, there was no meaningful consequence or accountability for racial harm. Racism is an attack on human dignity. It is a sin that demeans the image of God. More and more allegations of racism at Planned Parenthood continue to drip out of the organization in recent months. This report from BuzzFeed News is just the latest. I wish I could say that I am surprised, but racism is yet another symptom of a sick culture of death inside the abortion industry. It's a natural result of a business that profits off the death of the unborn And frankly, it's part of Planned Parenthood founder Margaret Sanger's vision, whom Planned Parenthood now even disavows over her deep belief in eugenic ideology. Let us continue to pray for a culture of life that upholds the dignity of every human being, regardless of race or stage of development. The Catholic Church has beatified a millennial for the first time. Blessed Carlo Acutis is this week's Pro-Life Focus.
Questo è il mio corpo offerto in sacrificio.
Carlo Acutis is now a blessed after being beatified on October 10th in a mass at the Basilica of St. Francis of Assisi. He is just one miracle away from being canonized a saint. The young Italian was born in 1991 and died of leukemia at the age of 15. The year before he died, the Italian teen researched Eucharistic miracles to create a website cataloging and sharing the information with others. And here's why he's our pro-life focus this week. Carlo was an only child, so when he died, his parents were left with no children. But in an interview with our news partner, Catholic News Agency, Carlo's mother, Antonia Acutis, says exactly 4 years after Carlo's death, she gave birth to twins at the age of 43. She says it's a miracle and attributes it to her son Carlo's intercession. The twins, a boy and a girl, were born in the world on the very anniversary of the day their big brother Carlo left it. The twins are now 10 years old, and you can see them at Saturday's beatification with their parents. We now have a new blessed to intercede for us in the pro-life movement. And to my fellow millennials, Blessed Carlo is a reminder for us all to strive for sainthood. Blessed Carlo, pray for us. That does it for this edition of EWTN Pro-Life Weekly. Until next time, we'd love to hear from you. Find us on social media at EWTN Pro-Life on all social media platforms. Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, we're there. You can also send us a message by emailing prolifeweekly@ewtn.com. We'd love to hear from you. Remember, life is a gift. Your life is a gift. God bless.